Okay, guys, we are live now. Thank you so much for your patience. I had to quick switch locations because the gardeners next door just showed up as I was starting to go live. And unfortunately, sometimes they come at 10:30 in the morning, sometimes they come at 12 right when I'm starting. So I quick switched to a different location. You still might hear some noise, but hopefully it won't be as loud. So thank you guys so much. Thanks for joining me. Thanks for your patience. I see a lot of you in the chat already, and it's a lot of fun to just hang out with you guys, talk about what's going on in your gardens. I know a lot of you are facing a ton of heat. So please let me know if you can see me and hear me okay, aside from the lawnmower noise. But hopefully you guys, it's not quite as hot in your garden as it is in mine. We had, I think it was Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 115 degrees, and then yesterday it actually was like 105. So cool off just a little bit. Today is close to 100 out here. I'm under a shade cloth, or not a shade cloth, I'm under an umbrella, and I'm drinking water because I'm already sweating. But I love to live stream outside. It's just not the same to live stream indoors. But today, excuse me, good. I'm glad you can see me and hear me. Today, I just want to talk a little bit more about some hot weather gardening tips. You guys have given me a lot of great ideas in the comments of the past couple videos. We posted a video on Friday, actually a day early than we normally post on Saturday, because I knew a lot of you in the South here in California were hitting that heat wave, and I really wanted you to have the information before the heat wave hit. And then we were able to get out and film in the evening when it cooled down just a little bit and post a little update on how the garden is doing. So I can't wait to hear some more of your tips, hear how your garden is doing. And I also want to share a little tip on pest control. Okay, so we're gonna get right into it, guys. And I love to see everybody in the chat. I've got my computer over next door to me so I can read the chat and everything. I see people from Kentucky, from Louisiana, from Sacramento, and let's see, Everything Sunflowers is moderating for me. Her name is Christy, so if you see her in the chat, that's what she's there for. So you can ask her any questions, and hopefully she'll be able to post a few links as well. So thanks for joining me. Also want to let you know that next week, we normally live stream on Mondays at noon Pacific time. Next week, we are off. We're not gonna be live streaming next Monday, but we will resume again the following Monday. I believe the date is 23rd of July. So anyway, we'll resume our live stream at noon Pacific time in 2 weeks. So if it's your first time joining us, welcome. We're all about growing your own food, quick, simple, inexpensive here, and so glad you're here. So how's things going in your garden? Is it hot where you're at? Is it cold? Are you in the Southern Hemisphere and coming into winter time? I'd love to hear more about how your garden is doing. I wanna just read, I'm gonna call this the viewer tip of the week. Hey, we are inside now, and not only is this a whole lot quieter, but it is cooler, so my phone won't overheat now. So guys, thank you so much for your patience. We're just resuming our live stream where we picked up, and it is great to see all of you guys here again. And again, we're talking today about some hot weather gardening tips. As you can see, it's super hot outside. My phone wouldn't even be able to handle it. So I was just getting ready to read here. Let me get my clipboard. I was just getting ready to read a viewer tip of the week. Okay, good. I'm glad you guys can see and hear me okay. I guess if it gets above about 90, 95, we're just gonna have to stream inside. So thanks for your patience. So a great tip this week from a viewer, and this viewer's name is Jump Off. And I absolutely love this tip. It fits very well with the weekend videos. And the tip is about shade cloth. And this viewer says, Jump Off is the name of the viewer. I used old torn bed sheets for shade cloth. I had to water 3 times the first day. I found that wetting the bed sheets really helped. Every plant made it except one pepper plant. I moved my zucchini under shade and watered heavily. I had a tree in a container under shade and some of the newly formed leaves wilted. So I love the tip, Jump Off. Thank you so much for sharing this tip of wetting down the bed sheets for shade cloth. I think that's wonderful. I never even thought of that. And I actually went outside last night. So I was checking my plants after the hot day and wet down my bed sheets. And that really does help keep the plants a lot cooler. So if you guys are facing those hot temperatures, give that a try. Whatever you can use for shade cloth, whether it's the shade cloth that I showed you on the video that we posted Friday, that's a 40% block. And that's a great one because it allows some of the sun to go through. But if you don't have that, use whatever you can. Old bed sheets, old tablecloths, old curtains. And I absolutely love the tip of wetting down the old bed sheets for shade cloth. So great tip there. Thank you so much for sharing. And I want you guys to make sure that you share your tips in the comments of the videos that I post on Instagram and also on Facebook and here on YouTube. And maybe you'll be the viewer, have the viewer tip of the week next week or in 2 weeks when you live stream again. Okay, Jack's having a blurry screen. Jack, try and refresh, see if that helps. If it continues to be a problem, if some of you could let me know. If you guys can see me and hear me okay, I'm thinking that most of you can. If you're having trouble, make sure you refresh your screen. Okay, let me just jump into the tips and then I want to head back over into the chat and take some questions and comments. Okay, first tip I wanted to mention, I've gotten a lot of questions on this. Okay, good, I'm glad to hear things are looking good. I've gotten a lot of questions on what about fertilizing during a heat wave? And what I wanted to share with you guys on that is I personally wouldn't use a high NPK fertilizer, like a fertilizer that has high nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium before or during a heat wave, because the plant's roots will work really hard to uptake that fertilizer, and you want to reduce the stress and the work that the roots of the plants have to do as much as possible during the heat, because they're going to be stressed enough dealing with the heat. So what I like to do is give them a really gentle fertilizer. And you guys know my favorite is Vermistera Worm Tea. It's just a great all-purpose fertilizer. And that's because it provides slow and steady growth to the plants. It has all those beneficial bacteria and microbes that really help the plants be healthy, help them cope with stress. And when they're healthier plants are coping with stressful situations like heat, they're going to be dealing with it a lot better. So it has a very low NPK. And I actually doused my whole garden with worm tea right before the heat wave hit. And then as it cools off this week, I'm gonna go ahead and douse everything with worm tea again, just to help them recover. So if you've never used worm tea, it's absolutely the best. And you can pick some up over at vermistera.com. And you can use my code CALLIEKIM and get a 10% discount. So it's pretty much the only liquid fertilizer I use in my garden now. I'm just having such great results. And it really just keeps things simple. So let me know in the chat if you've ever done any fertilizing during a heat wave, how it went for you. And I'd like to head over and answer some questions now. So Jack, oh yes, Jack, used a 24, 12, 15 fertilizer, which is a fertilizer with very big numbers. A few weeks ago maybe, Jack. The tomatoes are 8 feet tall, cucumbers are 10 feet, and my squash is pumping out flowers like crazy. Okay, Jack, it's great. It's great that you experimented, even though maybe it was by accident, and that things are going well for you. So that's the great thing about gardening is there's so many different ways to do things. You just gotta try things, experiment, see what works for you, and get it dialed in. So I personally like to use a lower dose fertilizer, like a NPK, like a fish fertilizer, which I think is a 5-1-1, possibly. It has a little bit higher of a nitrogen level as the plants are young. And then once they start flowering, back off, give them just a kind of a really well-balanced organic or liquid fertilizer, and that way they're producing more flowers and not as much leafy growth. So the nitrogen really helps with the leafy growth. So Jack, I'm glad it's working out for you. Okay, a couple questions here in the chat. Here, this one from Nisha. My strawberry plant doesn't have any flowers and fruits yet. What should I do? I use tomato fertilizer and Vermistera worm tea. Okay, Nisha, there's so many different factors that can affect strawberries. It really depends too on the variety of strawberries you're growing. There's different types of strawberries that produce at different times of the year, so that might have something to do with it. And it also really depends on the weather. Strawberries really like temperatures under 85 degrees. And once the temperatures hit higher than that, you most likely won't see fruiting and flowering. So you can go back and check my strawberry playlist on my YouTube channel. And you can watch those videos. I give some more information about the different varieties of strawberries. And hopefully that will help. And I want to let you guys know too, always search my channel. When you have a gardening question, there's a little search window there when you go to my channel. Search the topic that you're wondering about, and most likely I have a video on it, and that way you get your question answered right away in case I don't get back to you through email or through the comments. So give that a try, and hopefully you can get your questions answered very soon. Okay, let's see if we have another question here. And Chrissy has posted a link for the Vermistera worm tea and worm castings in the chat. Thank you very much, Christy. And I hear, let's see, here we go. From Lexi. Hi, Kim. I was wondering if humidity affects heat waves. I've been in the high 90s here on the coast of North Carolina and had only one plant die out. And it was a plant that was a cool weather plant anyways. Okay, so, well, humidity probably does raise the heat index. But, you know, there's so many different factors, again, depending on the location of your plants, if they're in the sun, if they're in the shade, the dryness, the humidity, all are factors that come into it, what kind of watering system you use, how much you water. So I'm really happy that your plants are doing so well, and it doesn't sound like maybe you have to do too many extra things to help them survive in the heat. So great job keeping those plants going. Okay, I'm going to head on to my second tip, and then we will come back into the chat and answer some more questions. So next tip is about trimming. I also had questions about this on the weekend videos, about trimming your plants during a heat wave. Now, you're going to probably have some plants that do dry up and get a little bit crispy, or some of the leaves get crispy, like you guys saw in my squash plant on that update video. But you don't want to trim them during the heat wave. And the reason for that is, even though the leaves are kind of crispy and scorched, they still do provide some type of shade protection for the plant itself or for surrounding plants. So you just want to leave those on there, even though I know, like, my first inclination is to go out there and trim everything off that I can. I don't like seeing those dried up leaves, but just wait till the temperatures dip down below 90, you know, mid-90s or in the 80s. And then go out and trim your dry leaves off. So you don't want to stress your plants out anymore by pruning them during the heat wave. You just want to get them through that heat. So little tip there for pruning during a heat wave. Hopefully that'll help you guys out. So later in the week here, it's supposed to drop down into the 80s. So I'll head out and then do my trimming all at once then. So let me know in the chat here if you've had any experience with that, and if that has helped or hindered your plants, or if you have any thoughts on that. Okay, so back to the chat here. And let's see here, from Julissa. Hi, Kim, I just moved to Florida and I got some seeds from you. I remember I sent that order out last week. Am I too late? Can I start cucumber seeds now, or am I too late? You are right on time, Julissa. So I would get those cucumber seeds started now. I actually have some brand new cucumber seedlings going in my grow light closet that I plan to plant out next week. But especially in Florida, you're in a warm climate. Cucumbers take probably about 60 days to go from seed to harvest. You have plenty of time there in Florida to get yourself some cucumbers before it gets cooler. So the issue for you might be, it might be a little hot right now. I'm not sure where you live in Florida, what your temperatures are like, but you may want to plant those cucumbers in a spot where they get a little bit of afternoon shade, or provide them with some shade cloth, and that way they don't dry up in the heat. But even people who live in cold winter climates, I always recommend starting kind of a later summer garden, because some of your plants are going to be dying out in late July, beginning of August. And it's always good to have some fresh new plants, like cucumbers and squash, plants that grow very quickly. It's good to have some fresh new plants so that you have harvests well into the fall, and hopefully right up until it frosts in your area. So I'll be doing a series on a late summer garden, and I will be coming out with a late summer garden seed collection, hopefully in the next 2 weeks. So you can get those fast growing vegetables planted in your garden and get a harvest before the cold weather hits. Because crazy enough, people are starting to think about fall gardening. So we'll have a fall gardening kit coming out soon, so make sure you stay tuned for that. So Julissa, definitely get those cucumber seeds planted right away. And you can direct seed them right outside, or you can start them indoors, get them off to a really fast start, and then get them out in your garden really soon. Okay, let's head over to the chat, take some more questions here. And I see a question from Kitten Lover. How do you keep deer out of your garden? I don't know. I don't have deer where I live, so I don't have that problem. I know a lot of people do fence off their gardens from deer. So if you have a tip or a comment for Kitten Lover on how to help her keep deer out of her garden, please post that in the chat. I'm sure she would really appreciate the help. Okay, Bob Miller here. Let's see, your comment just scrolled right by. Where did it go? I think it was about stick bugs. That he has a lot of stick bugs in his garden, and how do I get rid of them without using harmful pesticides? As a matter of fact, Bob, I just posted a video on neem oil, using a organic pesticide spray with neem, peppermint oil, and worm tea last week. So you want to go back and watch that video. I don't have a lot of experience with stick bugs, or are you meaning stink bugs? I'm not sure. I know the neem peppermint oil does help with the chewing and sucking insects, and the worm tea just really coats the leaves with a good coating of the beneficial bacteria, helps your plants be healthier, and really helps get rid of the insects. So you might want to go back and watch that video for a few more details on that. Okay, so let's see here. One more question from Maggie. Hi, Maggie, how are you doing? How big of a container should my tomato plants have? Okay, Maggie, great question. And yes, Mac just walked by. Come here, Mac. He's inside where the air conditioning is. He's no dummy. Okay, he's in here staying cool right with me, and maybe he'll come over and say hello. I don't know if he'll get behind me. Come here, Mac. You wanna say hi to everybody? There he is right there. Can you guys see him? Okay, anyway, about tomatoes and containers. It really depends on the variety of tomatoes that you have. If you have a small cherry type variety or a dwarf variety, those are great in a 5 gallon container. You guys have probably seen my little Smart Pots 5 gallon containers with the Calichem logo. Those are really fun to grow the dwarf tomatoes in, and I sell those on my website as well if you want to pick one up. The larger size tomatoes, though, in order for them to get to get to full size, you really want to grow them in a larger container. So either a 10 gallon, a 15 gallon, or a 20 gallon is really the best for a large full size tomato, from what I found, to get a lot of production out of them. And I love to grow them in the Smart Pots containers. They work really well. They're aerated, they have great drainage, and they're super easy to move around the garden. So give that a try, and hopefully that'll work really well for you. And I see that Everything Sunflowers and More has posted a great comment to Bob, I believe, was asking about stick bugs. I wasn't sure if he meant stick bugs or stink bugs, but she's posting that stick bugs are beneficial. So, Christy, thank you so much. I was not aware of that because I don't have stick bugs out here. So, Bob, if you want to get rid of your stick bugs, you might want to think twice and keep them around because they'll probably eat some of the other bad bugs that are wandering around your garden. Okay, so Christy, thank you so much. All right, next tip here from a question I had a lot of questions about shade cloth. So I just really wanted to clarify. Again, use whatever you can find for shade cloth. The ideal shade cloth is that 40% block that I picked up on Amazon. I'll pop a link down the video collection, video description. Show that on the video over the weekend. That's my favorite because it still allows some of the sun to come through. It blocks out 40% of the sun's rays, but it just keeps the sun from not being quite so intense, and it really does lower the temperature under that shade cloth. I've tested it before, and it's a good 5 to 7 degrees lower, so it really brings the temperature down. However, if you don't have that and you can't purchase it, no problem. Grab yourself, look around the house, grab your old curtains, your old bed sheets, your old tablecloths, and drape those over your tomato cages. Stick them in the ground with a couple of stakes, and it will block the sun during the heat wave. Now, I had a lot of questions. Is that going to be harmful to my plants to not have sun for a couple of days? Well, it'll be a lot more harmful to your plants to be exposed to like 100 plus degree temperatures. So they're going to be okay for a couple of days. Don't worry about it. As soon as the temperatures drop in the mid-90s, or below 90 degrees, you can go ahead and take off the shade cloth and things will be just fine. But if you need to leave it up long term, like if you live in a climate where it gets 100 plus degrees all the time, definitely recommend that 40% shade cloth. And I'll pop a link in the video description. So just a little clarification on that. Let's see. Yes, so you will remove the shade cloth once the temperature is cool. You're not going to leave the shade cloth on all summer long or anything. It's just for those few days of heat, just to protect your plants. And guys, it's working really well. I'm really happy with how it's going out there. You guys saw in the update video The tomato plant that was not shaded, it was shaded halfway up, looked great. The bottom half, the leaves got kind of dry and crispy. It still did pretty well, but definitely did have some heat damage on the lower leaves. So protect your garden with shade cloth. It's gonna be very, very helpful for you during a heat wave. Thanks, Sarah. I had to go inside because my phone was overheating and it's nice and cool in here. So Dizzy Izzy, super happy. That's great. You have 9 peppers on your jalapeno plant. It's so exciting to see your plants grow and develop even in the hot weather. So I was pretty excited to see that my kale and my chard and my New Zealand spinach was doing really, really well. I did have an umbrella over them, but the umbrella didn't quite cover them during the super hot part of the day. And I don't know if you guys saw, I think it was the video I posted on Sunday, they are taking the heat like a champ. Super heat tolerant greens. So if you guys are wanting to keep on growing your salads during the summer, the lettuce sometimes does tend to bolt. It will probably most likely will bolt and go to seed when the temperatures hit in the 90s, even mid 80s, and grow yourself some kale, some chard, some New Zealand spinach, absolutely delicious greens. Throw them in smoothies. You can pick up one of my heat tolerant seeds, heat tolerant green seed collections on my website. You've got 5 varieties in that collection and you can still keep growing your greens in the summer. I just picked up some red Russian kale this morning from my container garden and threw it in my smoothies. And, oh, it was so good and it's just so, so energizing. So, okay, back over the chat, guys, and let's take some more questions. All right, Pretty Alice Moon, how are you? Great to see you on here today. And Alice, you bought the shade cloth you linked to, and once it stops raining and gets really hot again, I'm gonna try it. That's great, Alice. I think you'll really, really be happy with it like I am. Okay, let's see. I'm actually gonna look off to the side here. Michigan Mike, you have some great ideas. Thank you. My question is, how do we get you to giggle? You do smile a lot, but really like to hear a joyful giggle. You answered all my questions except the one I just asked. Okay, Mike, I think you just had it there. You got me to laugh. So that's great. Thank you so much for enjoying the tips. I really appreciate it. And I guess I gotta have people post a lot of jokes and you might hear me laugh more. Okay, guys? Or maybe I'll have to come up with some jokes on my own. Okay, let's see here. Plastic greenhouse one summer eats plastic. Guess it's getting UV rays, not plant. Okay, not too sure about that. Patsella, I have to use shade cloth all summer. It will be removed when the temps get down to 105. Whew, that is very, very hot. Okay, Penny D, question, any tips on too much rain? Okay, well, not a whole lot you can do about Mother Nature. You could potentially put maybe a canopy over an area where you're getting too much rain, like maybe an Easy Up or something like that, or put it under like an umbrella of some kind. That might help protect it, but you do wanna be careful if you use like a tarp or anything like that, that you there's plenty of airflow. You don't wanna completely block your plant off, like completely drape the plant with a tarp or anything, because once the sun comes out, it's really gonna heat up under that tarp. So just be aware that you need to have plenty of airflow. I would suggest an umbrella or an Easy Up that's on stakes and poles and has lots of air going through it. So that might be helpful for you during areas of big heavy rain. So the other thing is make sure that all of your containers have really good drainage, and during periods of rain, that will really help all the excess moisture drain out. Okay, here goes, guys. Cole, this is a great question from Cole, because I have spaghetti squash growing too. I'm trying to grow some spaghetti squash and watermelons this year, and I'm wondering how long it takes for them to mature after flowering. Okay, Cole, spaghetti squash usually takes, I'm trying to think after flowering, mine are coming fast and furious, and I think the first flower was maybe 3 weeks ago, and I'm thinking I'll probably have a spaghetti squash to harvest in maybe 2 to 3 weeks. So I'm just growing your basic variety of spaghetti squash. So that would be about, I'd say 45 to 60 days after transplant. Now watermelon, it really depends on the variety of watermelon you're growing. If you have a small variety, like a sugar baby, I'd say probably maybe 45 days after flowering, probably 60 days after transplant. For large size watermelons, it can take 90 to 120 days. So you really do have to be patient with those. And also make sure that, or it really does depend on the weather too. If the weather's really hot or you're not getting a lot of sunshine, it's definitely gonna take a whole lot longer. So they need that long period of hot weather and warm nights to really mature. So check the back of your seed package. It'll probably tell you days to maturity from seed to harvest or from transplant to harvest. And those are under ideal conditions. So just keep that in mind and then go from there. Okay. It's been raining a lot. Okay, we just answered that question, Dizzy Izzy. You can put a tarp up if you're getting too much rain. And Camilla, I'm hoping that Camilla's here. I haven't yet seen her in the chat. Someone mentioned that there was a big storm that just went through Barbados, so I'm hoping that she is okay and her garden has survived. I see people talking to her in the chat, so I'm thinking she must be here. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and talk about the last tip here, and then we'll have some time left over for questions. So the last tip I actually wanted to mention has to do with the insect or pest control. So I posted a video last week on neem oil, the neem peppermint worm tea spray to help take care of the pests in your garden organically. And it works really well against the chewing and sucking insects like the aphids, like the white flies, like my mind is blanking here, the spider mites, against anything that's gonna chew on the leaves of your plants. However, having to do with the hot weather, you don't want to spray the leaves of your plants with the neem oil spray when temperatures get in the 90s or 100s. You really want to only do that when the weather is a little bit cooler. So, or you may want to do it as an alternative if you live in a super hot climate. You may want to do it in the evening and keep them shaded the next day. And the reason for that is, plants react differently during heat, and you definitely don't want to burn the leaves of your plants with the oil. So always, always, always do a test spray. If you're in high temperatures right now and you absolutely have an infestation, you really need to spray. Just spray one or two leaves of your plant and wait for 48 hours, see how that plant does, and then if things look really good and there's no damage or anything like that, then spray your plant down. But definitely use caution when you're spraying for insects during the heat, because the plants will just respond differently when, number one, when they're stressed in the high heat, and number two, when that hot sun hits whatever you spray on those leaves, it's gonna react differently in high temperatures than it does in cooler temperatures. So just use caution. If you can at all, wait until the temperatures go under 90 degrees and then take care of those insects. No, it's not Mac making noises. Actually, my son Drew just rolled out of bed, so he's in the kitchen making breakfast. So, hey, I know he wants to escape without saying hello, but Drew waved everybody, say hi.
Hi.
And I think he's having pizza for breakfast. Yeah. Yes, I know.
Most important meal of the day.
Most important meal of the day. Unfortunately, he's not a veggie lover, but you know, he's a teenager, so pizza for breakfast is probably par for the course for teenagers. If I have strawberries picked, he usually will eat some of the strawberries or I'll make him a smoothie, but today it's pizza. If you have teenagers, you know what I mean. Okay, guys, so let's head over to the chat here. And Alice, Alice, I love your comment. I keep telling people in the Facebook groups that they have to test spray their plants, and then when their plants react badly, they ask why no one told them. Okay, I know, sometimes it's trial and error, and unfortunately, sometimes you have to learn things the hard way, but yes, do test spray your plants, and please do that so you don't spray your whole garden down and then your garden dies and you're upset. But that does bring up another good point, Alice. Join the Facebook group of Gardening Coast to Coast. It is an absolutely wonderful group. I know a lot of you guys are members over there, and all you have to do is go to Gardening Coast to Coast on Facebook, click that you want to join, request to join, and then Gary or I will approve your request. You can go ahead and post photos of how your garden is doing. You can share tips and tricks. You can get great gardening support from all over the world. It's a wonderful group, so I highly encourage you to join the Gardening Coast to Coast Facebook group. You can also head over to my page on Facebook under Callie Kim, Garden and Home, and check out the posts I make there as well. Because on Instagram and Facebook is really where I post daily what's going on in my garden. a lot of pictures over there, and I share tips on my posts. And I also love to see your tips and your pictures of your garden as well. So if you're growing any of my seeds or growing any of my containers, please post a photo on social media and make sure you tag me. And hopefully I'll see it and I can go and see how the seeds are growing. So Alice, yes, Gardening Coast to Coast Facebook group is wonderful. You've learned so much, so I'm totally right there with you. It's really a wonderful group of gardeners. So let's see, B. Harris, I'm glad to hear you're enjoying Coast to Coast, Gardening Coast to Coast. And let's see if we have any other comments over here. Penny, I've been picking my caterpillars off and squishing them. Helps me get out of the frustration of them eating my plants. Okay, that's definitely one way to go about it. If you're too squeamish to squish those little green inchworms, you can also drop them into a little bucket of soapy water, and that'll help take care of them too. But just make sure that you're checking your garden every day during the heat or even during the nice weather, because you never know what's going on. And sometimes it's even fun to go out there at night with a flashlight and check things out, especially if you have kids, because there's all kinds of little creepy crawlies going on out there at nighttime. And sometimes it gives you a real clue as to what's going on in your garden, and it can really help you take care of any problems that you might have. So guys, I am gonna go ahead and sign off for today. Actually, let me take one more question here. I just saw a couple other questions scroll by. What do I need for the leaves on my cucumber plant to be darker? I'm thinking maybe you have some yellowing on your leaves. So first of all, you want to make sure that you're not overwatering your plants. If the soil is really soggy, you don't need to water. But secondly, you may need to give them a little bit of fertilizer. So compost is always a great thing to spread around the base of your plants. If you make your own, it's free. You can try some organic granular fertilizer. You can try some liquid fertilizer. I prefer organic. I prefer to use worm tea, and just give that to your plants regularly throughout the growing season to make sure that your plants stay healthy. Okay, guys, I am gonna sign off for today. Thank you so much for joining me on a hot Monday here. Hope you enjoyed the hot weather tips. Yes, Jack, stay cool and hydrated. I hope you all stay cool and hydrated and keep your gardens hydrated. But most of all, take care of yourself. Make sure you go out and garden in the early morning or in the evening. Don't put yourself in danger for your garden. Nothing is worth that. So remember, we are off next week. No live stream next week. We'll pick up again in 2 weeks. And if you missed the live stream, make sure you check the video upload of the live stream. It will replay. It will upload probably in about 45 minutes or so. I'll put links in the description and also a digital table of contents. All right, guys, check out my website for seeds for containers, CallieKimGardeningHome.com. And we'll see you guys in a couple of weeks. Bye-bye.